Today is Pentecost, the day when the church was born. Happy birthday, church. I didn't grow up in a church that recognized Pentecost much. And my understanding is this church didn't make a big deal of Pentecost until a certain organist joined the community. Am I correct? I think that's right. Yes. That was part of his job, I understand. You know, the Presbyterian Church is really down with Jesus, really big on God the Creator, but the Holy Spirit sometimes gets short shrift. I think that this is because the Holy Spirit is a bit of a wild card, unpredictable, more comfortable with chaos than us order-minded Presbyterians. I think it's time that we have some serious conversations about this third party of the Trinity, because our world is seeming a bit chaotic these days, and we need the Holy Spirit's inspiration to deal with our crazy world. I think the Holy Spirit, this aspect of God, can teach us a whole lot. But first, I would like to back up a moment to talk about the Holy Spirit. Those of you who have been with me in the Inquirers class, and even before this, we show a short video, and in it, Mark Linval, the pastor of Brick Presbyterian Church in New York City, has a lovely summary of what the Trinity is. It really helps to make sense. He says, first, there's God the Creator, the one who breathed life on the earth and made it and created us all and everything we have. Then there's God the man, Jesus, who came and walked the earth, walked among us, breathed the air we breathe, ate the food we eat, and died for our sins and was risen. And then there's the Holy Spirit. He defines the Holy Spirit as God's present operating in our world, in our lives. The Holy Spirit is God at work. All three are God. But when I talk about the Holy Spirit in this sermon, I am imagining God's plan in action, God's work, God's design. Now, I think our scripture passages today pretty much are the best summaries in the Bible of what the Holy Spirit does. And we're going to focus today on three aspects of God's work, three things to describe how God's work in our midst as a community is important. It's unexpected. It's undeniable. And it's leveling. I tried to come up with a U word for that one. I looked through the thesaurus and I just couldn't find one. So we have unexpected, undeniable, and leveling. So we find our apostles in this passage from Acts. They're holed up in a house in Jerusalem after Jesus had gone up into heaven. You remember last week we talked about this passage and the disciples were just kind of staring up into heaven. What? This is right after that. So they've gone and they're worshiping in a house together. Now, it happened to be a big holiday when Jews from all over returned to Jerusalem to celebrate their faith. In this case, it's the celebration of God's giving the law to Moses. And this happened approximately 50 days after the Passover in Egypt. So it's called Pentecost, because that's the Greek word for 50. We still celebrate Pentecost because it's approximately 50 days since Easter, right? But the Jewish people celebrated Pentecost first. It's also called the Festival of Weeks, and it was a springtime harvest festival, a time of celebration and thanksgiving for God's goodness. So the Holy Spirit just happened to come on a holiday already in progress. But unexpected things began to happen. First, there's the wind, and then flames appear above the heads of the disciples. And then they begin to speak in other languages. That's incredible. That is not something that the disciples planned to have happen. There was no orchestrated religious pageantry. Peter was not standing at the pulpit calling forth the wind and the flame. The disciples were just there. They were instruments of God's working, God's plan. And they did not intend to spread the gospel that day. That was not their intention. They were just worshiping God. The surprise, the unexpectedness comes from those people that were in the street around them. Now, I imagine that it was a house with, they didn't have glass for windows necessarily. It was usually very open. It was a springtime around now, so it was quite hot there. So I imagine that these were people just gathered in the street, happened to be passing by. There were people that were living in the houses around them, perhaps 9 in the morning, enjoying a breakfast together on their balcony or on the rooftop. And they heard people speaking in their own language the mighty deeds of God. Now, most of you know that I spent a few years in Egypt, and I remember what it's like to be in a crowded restaurant with many conversations going on around me, or even on the metro when I'm in the long line of very crowded groups of people standing around me and my little, very little kids. Have you ever had that experience when you're traveling and you're in one of those situations where no one is speaking your language and suddenly you hear English? It's like your ears make a beeline. Everything else sort of fades away and you are listening to those cadences of your youth. The vowels and the consonants, the rhythms, it's like music. And you immediately begin to search for the source of that language, that part of your childhood that you heard your mother speak. Is it any wonder that the people passing by from all these countries, we did not actually speak all those countries with our children, but there's like a list of like 12 countries that is in the book of Acts. Egypt and Crete and Parthia and Turkey, all of these places where there were Jewish people, both born Jewish and those that adopted the Jewish faith. So that these were people that did not grow up in Jerusalem. They were not speaking Aramaic. They were like us when we visit a foreign country. They sort of knew some of the sounds. They knew Hebrew a little bit from the scriptures. But they were still trying to kind of find their way. A lot of babble around them. And suddenly they're passing in the street and, wait, that's my language. Is it any wonder that they stopped and listened? It would be like the music, a favorite melody perhaps, that the Holy Spirit arrives like a song, an unexpected, impossibly beautiful song that you cannot ignore. God's work will always surprise. God's work will always be what we do not expect. And then God's work is undeniable. The Holy Spirit is like a magnet. You cannot ignore it. Why? Well, the Holy Spirit, first of all, draws all kinds of people in. And you can tell from their reactions to the sounds of the languages around them. Some are filled with wonder, but others are cynically making fun of them for being drunk. You can imagine the kinds of people that are there, right? You can imagine like one of your friends saying, no way, they're just drinking in there, Where you're going, why? All these reactions, all these different people trying to make sense of this really weird thing. But the Holy Spirit works by meeting people in their inmost foundational places. They have to stop and listen because it's the language of their earliest memories. And what they're saying, the language they're hearing, those words, are God's mighty deeds. Friends, we were made to praise God. And when you hear that in your language, in a place where you are a foreigner, a tourist, it is like magical. Now, lest you imagine that the voices the people heard were like angels dubbed over them, the people gathered saying, but wait a minute, aren't those people, aren't they Galileans? As if these would be the last person that they would imagine being able to speak a foreign language like that. How did they know? How did they know the people in that house were Galileans? It was the disciples' accents that gave it away. The Holy Spirit spoke through the disciples, but it was their voices that the Holy Spirit used. It was their words, not some perfect dubbing from angels speaking out of the flames. God speaks through us as we are, with all of our histories, with all of our feelings, our insecurities, everything. However ill-equipped we are for God's work, if we ask God to speak through us, and if we're willing to get out of God's way, people will stop and listen. Because what God has to say is to the very deepest part of who we are. At the end of this chapter in Acts, it records that 3,000 were added to their number that day, a day when they were not intending to preach the gospel. The Holy Spirit is undeniable. So, undeniable, unexpected. The hardest thing of these three aspects is the leveling part, because the Holy Spirit does not play favorites. I mean, we're always putting in people in a hierarchy of order, aren't we? We may not be aware of it, but I think we often, like characters in an 18th century novel, we're fine with a group of people so long as everyone knows their place. Human beings are competitive. We're ambitious, and God can work with that, but not in the way that we can imagine. God cannot work with us when we are competitive for ourselves, or when we put people above or below us. I mean, the first example in the scriptures, that the people listening to that day were not powerful, they were not the influential, they were anybody's. They were tourists. They were from all over the then known world. God calls everyone. And this problem of the hierarchies is what Paul was dealing with when he wrote his letter to the Corinthians. Now, there were some pretty severe problems in Corinth. And much of their problems had to do with people trying to figure out who was the most important. And it attacked this church on many levels, from who got to eat first, to which one was more important because they listened to this preacher or that preacher. Even certain jobs they had in the church gave higher status to different church members. Now, in this church, speaking in tongues was a big deal. If you could speak in tongues, you, my friend, you got to sit in the front row, you know? You got to be up front with the pastors and everyone preaching because you were favored by God. And it's not, as a side note, this is not the same kind of tongues as we have in our first passage in Acts, okay? This was sort of like a heaven language that people, when they were in an ecstatic form of prayer, could speak. Not unlike Pentecostal churches today. This is how the Holy Spirit manifests itself in people when they are in a prayerful state, so connected with God. The people were not speaking languages from different lands. They were speaking a language of heaven. But in Corinth, everyone thought that the ones who could do this were the most important, that they had a higher status. Paul is trying to tell the Corinthians in this passage that there is no hierarchy of gifting. The Spirit gives gifts as the Spirit will. And every gift is important. But here's the key: so long as it benefits the community. And that's the test. You can't go speaking in tongues unless there's someone there to interpret it. Because it can't just be for you. It can't just be, you know, you're speaking some, you know, something nobody else can understand. It would be like me giving a sermon in Latin, you know. I'm sure you all would nod and say, wow, she's really smart, but who does it benefit, right? This is exactly the same thing. You can't speak in tongues unless there's someone there who can interpret what you're saying so that everyone can benefit. So for God to speak, for God to act, we need to recognize that we are all on the same level. In the Presbyterian Church, that's the reason why we call, there's two kinds of elders. There's ruling elders and teaching elders. It's not like they put pastors on this pedestal. We're just people in this community that are called to a specific task. My status is no more higher to God than any of the rest of you. David's status is not any higher. What would it mean for us to be a leveling community? A place where everyone could be present and celebrated for their gifts. Can we give up our insider status so that others feel part of our community, our circle? I found this picture on Pinterest. I think maybe some of you have seen it. I'm not sure. But it was a picture of about 20 children somewhere in Africa. And they're sitting in a circle, and their legs are towards the center of the circle so that all of their feet are touching. You cannot tell whose feet belong to what child. The story that's accompanying the picture is about an anthropologist who's tried to teach the children a game, a very simple one, where they would race to a tree in the distance, and the first one there gets to win the basket of fruit. Simple, right? And so when the anthropologist said, go, the children grabbed hands and they all ran together. They got to the tree and they shared the fruit. The man asked the children, why did they do that, right? And they said, Ubuntu. How could we be happy while the rest of us were sad? Ubuntu means I am because we are. I love that. What would our church be like if we lived like those children? Friends, I believe the Holy Spirit is at work right now, right here. Our community, our leaders are committed to being a welcoming and accessible community. Just by being here today, you are grabbing hands and heading to the fruit basket. But I think some of you sitting here today are thinking that you don't have any gifts the Holy Spirit can use. You've heard the word in your heart speaking in your deepest center, but you haven't allowed God to work. To you, I say, your gifts are welcome here and necessary here. Whether you are a greeter, an usher, a Sunday school teacher, a coffee pourer, a lettuce chopper, a soup ladler, the Holy Spirit will work through you. Get busy. Get involved. And we can do so much more outside of these walls. Can you the language of someone's heart this week? Can you surprise them with an act of grace? We can allow the Holy Spirit to act through us in unexpected ways, in undeniable ways, benefiting everyone. Just like that day so many years ago, during a national holiday in a house with open windows. Let God work and see what kind of community we can be. Let it be so. Amen.